Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Mathieu Perrin. I'm going to present to you an innovation that we developed in Dolphin that is called the OHM, the Offshore Heavy Maintenance Enabler for a floating wind turbine. So first, let me introduce Dolphin. So Dolphin is a French company created 20 years ago, a bit more than 20 years ago, and specialized in the service of the energy sector. So first, historically, Dolphin was specialized in inspection and audit of offshore drilling rig through its subsidiary Factorig. And more recently, Dolphin has also acquired a company called 8.2 France that allow Dolphin now to be present in the renewable sector in the inspection and audit also. In addition to that, Dolphin is also providing technical assistance and expertise. And last but not least, because it is my part, Dolphin has a small engineering department that studied a few years ago with the help of the French ADEME an holistic semi-sub called the Truss Float. And this semi-sub has been developed for a 6-megawatt turbine and is now upscaled to a 15-megawatt turbine because the turbine size is increasing over the past few years. Okay, but the subject today is not really to talk about the semi-sub, but is to talk about how to repair a semi-sub or a barge offshore, basically. So today, the industry of the floating wind is saying that if there is a problem on the semi-sub, if there is typically a blade to change or a gearbox to change, instead of replacing it on site, the industry is saying basically that you have to go back to port to tow the floater back and to repair it to the port and then to bring back the floater. But doing such a trip is in fact meaning that you need to disconnect the electrical cable of the floater. You need also to disconnect all the mooring. You can have up to 12 mooring lines on this floater. You need also to tow the floater to a maintenance port that is able to repair it. Then, once repaired, you need to do the opposite, so to bring back the floater to the site, to reconnect the mooring, and then to reconnect the electrical cable. After a few years, those operations, at the end, are risky operations, and when you accumulate all those operations, they require very good weather conditions, in fact. When you start to disconnect a floater and tow it for several days, you need a weather window that is equivalent to a summer sea condition. So if you add to this the interface with the port, that constitutes another project risk, basically, you understand why it will be necessary to do the heavy maintenance on site, in fact. So how to do the heavy maintenance of the floater on site? First, what you have to do is to reach the hub. So the hub, you can see it, it's the nacelle over there. So it's on the new turbine size, already a very, very high height to reach, basically. You need typically a boom height for a vessel, a boom height of more than 170 meters, which most of the vessel available today does not have such a crane boom height, basically. If you reach the hub, the second problem that you have is to manage the relative motion between your crane and the rotor, because you have to imagine that the crane is on a maintenance vessel and the rotor is on another floater. So basically, both floaters live their life and you need to be able to enter the bolt that you see here in the hole that are inside the rotor. So it's another challenge, okay? And last but not least, if you want to change a gearbox, for instance, you will need to manage the swinging motion. So the operation that you see here, where the gearbox is lowered with cable, tomorrow on the floater, this is an operation that is not doable. Because when you will have a long cable to lower your gearbox, with the movement of the floater, typically the pitch of the floater, the system will have a swinging motion that you will be not that will not be possible to control, and therefore you will not avoid the gearbox to hit the mast and so on. So basically, this is another issue. So that's why today everybody say let's go back to the port. That's the reason behind that. So what we propose in Dolphin, enfin, is a solution that calls the home, so offshore heavy maintenance enabler, that permits to reach the hub with a telescopic mast to avoid relative motion, because in fact you are on the floater, your system is on the floater, is not on a separate vessel, and last because there is no cable, you don't have any swinging motion. Okay. So let me show you a quick video that we have done, an animation that we have done of the system for a blade change, typically. So the idea is to come with an heavy lift vessel, a standard heavy lift vessel, to first install what we call some kind of interface structure that is land on the and fixed to the floater. Then to install the telescopic system with a five-axis table on top. Then to pick up the blade yoke and install it on the five-axis table. To bring the table up to the hub, basically by telescoping the system. Then to grab the blade, to disconnect the blade, and to lower the complete system to retract the telescopic system in order to be able to pick up the blade yoke with an internal lifting clamp, basically. Once you have lowered it back to the deck of the vessel, you pick up the new blade and you do the opposite. So why do I call it a five-axis table? Is because we have five axes of freedom in order to align both flange of the blade, and the six axes of freedom that is given by the pitch of the blade, basically. So it's directly managed by the rotor itself. So what we can say on the system typically is that it will be compatible with most semi-sub and barges. What you need at the end of the day is to have some room and to have some excess of buoyancy. This is our thrust float, 15 megawatts, but this is another barge type, well-known barge type that we have one in France. And this is another type of floater as well that tomorrow can be adapted for the system to be able to pick up the blade. What I forgot to mention is, of course, the system is quite stable, but once you have land the different part, you trim slightly the floater. So what you need to do before telescoping up the system is basically to counterbalance the other compartment in order to have the system back in horizontal, basically. But, this is a detail. Okay, so... So the home is a modular solution, in fact. So at the top, for instance, you will have this five-axis table that is functional to install the blade. At the bottom, you will have what we call a temporary structure, that is the interface structure, that is an important piece, basically, that is designed to limit the structural reinforcement on the floater. So that means typically that this structure, you will have one per farm. It will be size for your floater, for your farm, and it will land and directly on the hard point of the floater, basically. So you will in order not to reinforce to add too many steels to the system, basically, you will have, for instance, pad eye here, and at point where the structure is able to take the loads, basically. It's more important to have minimum reinforcement on the hull because you will build many floaters and a structure, an installation head that is a bit more clever, basically. So the installation is clever and the floater as small as light as possible. Okay. So you will keep one of these interface structure on your farm, enfin at your logistic base. You will build one in addition to your 100 Flutter. And later on, if you have a problem, you will rent the rest of the tooling, basically. That's the idea. So you will always have an interface structure that fits your own Flutter. And that is important in offshore. You have to avoid surprise, basically, like not being able to fit correctly when you land the structure. Why do I say it's modular? It's modular because typically at the top, you can also add some kind of arm in order to increase a bit the admissible weather. Why do we put the arm? Is in fact because even if the two masts are on the same flutter, at the end of the day, those are slender structure and their behavior is basically independent one from each other. So you still have you don't have relative motion, but you have relative displacement between the two arms. So the idea is here to lock the two arms together with the arm, the two masts together with the arm in order to be able to install the blade in a stressless manner, basically. Another important tool, typically, is the top crane that we have, that we can be envisaged on the top of the telescopic arm. This crane will be used to handle or to carry all the large components that you have to replace in the nacelle. Typically a gearbox. Why is it important to have this possibility? Because in fact we need to cover all the aspects of the heavy maintenance, and typically changing the gearbox is also an aspect of the maintenance. So basically what you do is you put your telescopic system closer to the mast on the interface piece, and then you change the top part, you put the top blade instead of the 5-axis table. And you are able to pick up the gearbox. The beauty of it also is that once you have taken the gearbox, you can lower the system using the telescope instead of using just the cable. So basically, you don't have the swinging problems that I was talking about at the very beginning. So the advantage of the home is that compared to other methods of maintenance on site, our system is not hanging on the mast, is not creating any basically constraint on the mast and on the turbine. So we can accommodate our system with all the turbines of the market today. We will just have the telescope will stop at the right height. We don't touch the mast. We don't grip the mast, except with a temporary gripper, but at the very high and reinforced level that is the yaw of the nacelle. Apart from that, we are compatible with most of the turbine. Okay. It will require also a standard heavy lift vessel. I mean that the crane that we are expecting to have on such a reparation is a 100-meter crane. So it's a vessel that you can find within this industry without any problem. And what is important also to highlight is that we use safe and field-proven offshore operation. That means that we are just lifting loads from one flutter to another, and this is this is the kind of operation that we are doing on a daily basis in oil and gas. So it's nothing new than what we do traditionally. We don't even, one point that needs to be highlighted also is that we don't upend the blade as well. We just take the blade horizontally and we lift it and we dock it horizontally, which is also with a 120-meter blade, a safer operation than to try to open it, basically. And compared to a TOBA two-port solution, our solution we need to prove it, but it will most likely be cheaper in terms of CapEx, because even if you will reinforce a bit the flutter to install your four paradise at the end of the day, the fact not to have to take care of a temporary absence of a flutter will definitely reduce the equipment that you will need on your, or the layout of, will simplify the layout of your wind farm, and basically you will avoid typically to have a temporary buoys or a system that could connect the cable together, or even some return cable in order to cope with the absence of a flutter, or even quick connector for the mooring line or this kind of thing. So at the end of the day, we are almost sure that in terms of capex, you will save money if you consider that no flutter going go back to port. The second point is that it will reduce project risk, because as I said originally, disconnecting a flutter and bring it back to port and disconnecting an interface, enfin, an inter-array cable is a risky operation, especially to reconnect those, basically. And what we have also performed an estimation of the repair cost. 2 days of a vessel, even a Navy Leaf vessel, 2 days of a Navy Leaf vessel to perform such an operation will be far cheaper than the several weeks of tugs that you will have to take if you go back to port. So it's a cheaper repair at the end of the day, and it's also a quicker repair, meaning that in 2 days you do the job. Tomorrow, if you want tugs and you want to do it back to port, you will first need to have the right weather window, and second, your towing back to port and come back will take several weeks. So here also, you will save production by doing the operation directly on site. We envisage, enfin, according to our calculation, each time you will have a problem on the turbine, you will save at least 50% of the cost. So our roadmap for the tool is basically to, with my team, we are completing a FEED that we expect to complete by the beginning of next year. Talking with all the actors in order to evaluate all the needs for the tool and make the tool as useful as possible. The second phase will be to go for a prototype. So we intend to do a prototype scale one and to take the decision to do it by Q2 next year. So we invite everybody that could be happy to participate to join us anyway, because this will cost a bit, and we cannot do it, manage it alone. We believe that 2 years after we'll be in a position basically to test the system offshore. What I want to add also to this is that this system has been sought originally to do some repair offshore, but it can also be used typically on a jack-up tomorrow to fulfill, to be able to install or to repair blades on jack-up that tomorrow cannot reach the hub anymore because the turbines are getting higher and higher. So having a tool, a jack-up with a reasonable crane and a telescopic tool could make the life much easier and much cheaper to intervene on a bottom fix field. So I think that's it for me. So thank you very much.